हेलो डियर स्टूडेंट्स, हेलो ट्वेल्थ बायो स्टूडेंट्स, गुड आफ्टरनून टू एवरीवन। जॉइन फॉर द क्लास, आई वेलकम यू ऑल टू द ट्वेल्थ बायोलॉजी क्लास। मायसेल्फ जलजा सजीव, पीजीटी बायो फ्रॉम केवी बीएसएफ कैंप छाबला, इन फ्रंट ऑफ यू once again I am welcoming you all to the biology class. Today we are going to the chapter 2 in class 12th biology, sexual reproduction in flowering plants. So the objective of learning this chapter, helping you students to understand some of the content areas, some of the facts, concepts in biology, that is the structure of a typical flower, structure of different parts of the flower in detail, structure of anther, structure of pollen grain, how they are formed, that is microsporogenesis, megasporogenesis, then structure of ovule and all. So after learning these different content areas, you must be able to identify the different types of flowers and the different parts of a typical flower. You must be capable of identifying the andrecium and gynoecium, an anther and a carpel, difference between microsporogenesis and megasporogenesis. You should be able to explain the structure of a typical ovule. So these are the expected learning outcomes after learning this chapter. Now, before going to the detailed content, the previous knowledge regarding this chapter is, what is a flower? You know, what is a flower? अगर हमने कोई कॉमन लोगों से पूछा तो वो बताएगा पूजा के लिए यूज कर रहे चीज, ऑफ कोर्स, बट साइंटिफिकली इट इज ए मॉडिफाइड कंडेंस्ड शूट. फ्रॉम वेयर इट डेवलप्स? इट डेवलप्स फ्रॉम ए ग्रुप ऑफ मेरिस्टमैटिक सेल. And that meristematic cell, that is known as primordium. Primordia plural, primordium singular. So what is primordia? Where it is located? Primordia is a group of actively dividing cell meristems. It may be seen at the tip of the plant, tip of the shoot system, or it may be seen as on the axil of the leaf. So you can see in a plant, flowers may be either terminal or it may be axillary. If terminal bud develops into flower, you can see flower at the tip of the plant. And if axillary bud is developing into a flower, then you can see it on the axil of the leaf. So again, scientifically, what is flower? It is the organ that is meant for reproduction in plants. So flower is the reproductive organ or the site of reproduction in plants. Here you can see beautiful flowers and of a pansies and these owl shaped flower also. Now, different whorls of a flower. Whorls means layers. There are present two different layers in a particular flower. One is essential whorls. The other is non-essential whorls. Now, what is meant by essential whorl? Essential whorls means it is essential for reproduction. Without that whorl, there won't be any reproduction at all in plants. So, what comes under these essential whorls? Your answer is andrecium and gynoecium. Here in this diagram, you can see the andrecium made up of stamens and the entire gynoecium. So, andrecium and gynoecium are the essential whorls of a flower that helps in reproduction. And the second whorl, second layer is non-essential. That means it is not necessary for reproduction. Even if it is absent, then also there occurs reproduction. So, what are those non-essential whorls? That is calyx and corolla. So, these are the non-essential whorls, calyx and corolla. Now, what are the different parts of a typical flower? I think you all have learned these aspects in your previous class. Even then, a little bit detail we will go here. So, most of these flowers, they have mainly four different parts, main parts. First part, here in this diagram, you can see the stalk of the flower. What term we will give for this stalk of the flower? Stalk of the flower is known as pedicel. Then, so this stalk of the flower pedicel, it enlarges. It forms a flat disc-like structure at its tip. And this part, that is known as receptacle, or other name is thalamus, or at another name torus. So receptacle, thalamus, or torus, that is the tip of the pedicel that swells and forms a flat disc-like structure. And this disc-like structure, that is known as receptacle. Then, in this receptacle, they are arranged different other whorls. That is the first whorl, non-essential whorl, that is calyx. Here you can see the calyx, green in color. It is the outermost whorl. Its function is protection. And since it is green in color, what may be its function? Yes, photosynthesis. And in some flowers, this calyx is colored also. So, if it is colored, then what is its function? So, there, in that particular case, it helps in attracting the insects for pollination. So, different functions. One, main function protection. Second, photosynthesis. And third, if it is colored, then it will helping in pollination. Now, what is its unit? Calyx, that is made up of unit. The unit is known as sepal. Here you can see two sepals in this diagram. And if all these sepals, if in some of the plants it is fused, what is the term given for that? Yes, try to recollect. In your 11th class morphology, you have learned the same thing. That is gametosepalus. And if all the sepals are free, then we can say it as polysepalus. Poly means many, free. polycephalus. Now the second world, that is non-essential world, that is corolla. Here you can see the red colored corolla portion, and it is made up of unit. The unit is known as petal. So what is the unit of a corolla? Petal. And here it is red in color, colorful. It varies, the color varies in various plants. It differs depending upon the pigment present in it. So why this is colored? What is its advantage? It is colored to attract the insects for pollination. Then another function is protection. It is protecting the internal worlds. Here also the condition is applicable just like that of petal. If all the petals are free, then what term you will give? Polypetalous. Good. And if all the petals are fused, then what is the term applied for it? Gamopetalous. Gamo means united. Gamopetalous means all the petals are united to form a single tubular structure. Then the second part, that is essential worlds. In essential worlds, the first one, that is andrecium. What is its unit? Stamens. Andrecium is the male sex organ of a flower. It is made up of unit. The unit is stamen. Then female sex organ, the second part of essential world, that is gynoecium. Gynoecium is the female sex organ of a flower, and its unit is called as a carpel. Unit of a gynoecium or pistil is known as carpel. Gynoecium is otherwise known as pistil, and its unit is known as carpel. Then here again you can see in this diagram, everything is, once more it is clear. Andrecium, it is the essential world, reproductive world, and male sex organ, and it is made up of stamens. See here, one stamen is enlarged here with the anther, filament, pollen grains, everything you can see here in this diagram. And gynoecium, that also you can see here, the female sex organ, gynoecium, and made up of a unit, that is carpel. Now we are going to the structure of a single stamen. What is stamen? Stamen is the unit of andrecium. What is andrecium? It is the male sexual organ in a flower. Now what are the parts of an anther? Have you seen this type of a structure in a lily flower or in any of the flower? Yes. So here it possesses two parts. What are the two parts? One, filament, that is the stalk of the anther, that is known as filament, or upper two lobed structure. The upper bilobed structure, that is known as anther. So an anther has two parts. One is filament, that is the stalk of the stamen. It is where it is attached, where this stamen is attached in a flower. It is attached in the thalamus. All the floral worlds, calyx, corolla, andrecium, gynoecium, all these floral worlds that are arranged in the thalamus. That is at the tip swollen part of the pedicel. Another name of a thalamus is torus or receptacle. And in some cases, here you can see a flower. And in this particular flower, you can see the stamens are attached over the petal. Stamens you can see on the petal. So that means stamens may be attached either in the receptacle or it can attached in on the surface of a petal. So if it is attached on a petal, petal ka upar attached hai, so it is known as epipetalous stamen. Epipetalous stamen. Then in some cases, we can't identify it as petal or it as a sepal. For example, in lily flower. So in such cases, the stamens, that floral part that is known as perianth, it is neither calyx nor corolla. So that type of structure is known as perianth. And the unit of perianth is called as tepal. And in that case, it is known as epiphyllous stamens. Phyll means leaf-like structure. Epiphyllous means, epi means above. Above that leaf-like structure, tepal, it is attached. Stamens are attached. So it is known as epiphyllous stamens. So when you are observing this structure, here each anther has two lobes. Then each lobe has again two chambers. You can see it clearly. So an anther is bilobed. An anther has two lobes, so we can say it as it is bilobed. Then when you are observing each lobe, again it is divided into two chambers. So it is called a dithecous. Dithecous anther. So bilobed anther, because it possesses two lobes. Each lobe has two chambers or theca, or known as microsporangium. Hence, or other term is pollen sac. So it is known as dithecous. So an anther is, a typical angiosperm anther is bilobed and dithecous. Clear? Now, structure of an anther. Here in this diagram, you can see the cross section of an anther. An anther has four lobes. Two anther lobes, and each lobe is again having two chambers or pollen sacs or microsporangium or theca. So it is a butterfly shaped structure. Here you can see, and these cells, they are all parenchyma cells. Here you can see the connective. Anther is the two lobes of the anther that is connected, and on the back side with the help of a connective, the filament that is attached with this anther lobes at its back with the help of connective, and that connective is having vascular bundle also. Now, what are the different wall layers present in an anther? An anther has four different wall layers. What are they? You can see here in this diagram, the outermost layer, single layer, made up of elongated, compactly arranged parenchyma cells, epidermis. Epi means above, derma means layer. So, sabse bahar ka layer, that is epidermis. Then, second layer that is known as endothecium. Endothecium. Then, 2 to 3 layers, that is mid layers. Then, the innermost layer, that is known as tapetum. Again, 2 mark question. വാട്ട് ആർ ദ ഡിഫറൻറ്റ് ലെയേഴ്സ് ഓഫ് അനാന്തർ? ഔട്ടർ എപ്പിഡോമിസ്, ദെൻ എൻഡോതീഷ്യം, 2 to 3 ലെയേഴ്സ് ദാറ്റ് ഈസ് നോൺ ആസ് മിഡിൽ ലെയേഴ്സ്, ആൻഡ് ഇന്നർ മോസ്റ്റ് ലെയർ ദാറ്റ് ഈസ് നോൺ ആസ് എപ്പിഡെർമിസ്. എപ്പിഡെർമിസ്, വാട്ട് ഈസ് ദ ഫങ്ഷൻ ഓഫ് എപ്പിഡെർമിസ്? ഇറ്റ് ഈസ് ദ ഔട്ടർ മോസ്റ്റ് ലെയർ. സോ വാട്ട് ഈസ് ദ ഫങ്ഷൻ? പ്രൊട്ടക്ഷൻ. ഇറ്റ് ആക്ട് ആസ് എ പ്രൊട്ടക്റ്റീവ് ലെയർ ഫോർ ദ പോളൻ ഗ്രെയിൻസ്. And it also help in dehiscence. There is a part in this anther lobe that is made up of a thin-walled parenchyma cell that is called as a stomium. And this stomium helps in dehiscence of the anther and release of the pollen grains. So the second layer that is called as endothecium. Endothecium is having fibrous thickenings, and these fibrous thickenings are present in the radial walls as well as on inner walls, and it is made up of alpha cellulose. It helps in protection as well as dehiscence. These fibrous thickenings, they will absorb water and swells up, and it helps in dehiscence of the anther. Then middle layers, 1 to 3 layers are there, and they help in protection. Innermost layer of an anther, that is called as tapetum. Very important question. What is tapetum? Where it is located? What is its function? And mention any 2 characteristics of it. Very important question for your board examination. So tapetum, it is known as the nutritive tissue. Why it is known as nutritive tissue? Because it gives nourishments to the pollen grains. Developing pollen grains, they will get nutrients from the tapetal layer. So it is known as nutritive layer. Now what are the characters of these tapetum? Cells contains dense cytoplasm. It stores all the nutrients. It is dense and granular. Then it may be uninucleate or binucleate or multinucleate. That is the characteristics of a tapetum, and it stores nutrients. So these are the 3 different characters. Cells are having, all the cells that possess dense granular cytoplasm and stores nutrients for the developing pollen grains, and it is uninucleate, binucleate or multinucleate. Now what is meant by sporogenous tissue? Here again comes at another important question. Name the homogeneous tissue present in an anther. So your answer is sporogenous tissue. 1 more question. And it is made up of parenchyma cells. And these sporogenous tissue, they are seen at the center of this microsporangium. Now we are going to the important 5 mark question or 3 mark question. That is microsporogenesis. So what is meant by microsporogenesis? Genesis means formation. Microsporogenesis means genesis of microspores. That means formation of microspores or pollen grains from pollen mother cell by meiosis or reduction division. So this process of formation of microspores or pollen grains from pollen mother cell by meiosis or reduction division, that is known as microsporogenesis. So the sporogenous tissue that present inside the microsporangium of an anther, it becomes specialized. Some of the cell will modifies, stores extra nutrients, enlarges its size, and it acts as pollen mother cell. Or we can say it as microsporocyte. Cyte means cell. Microspore or pollen grain banana wala cell. So it is called microsporocyte. So or pollen mother cell. It is represented as PMC. P for pollen, M for mother, and C for cell. So what is the ploidy of this particular cell? What is the ploidy of a sporogenous tissue? Diploid. So diploid pollen mother cell, it undergoes which division? Meiosis, reduction division, to form haploid spores. And those spores are known as pollen grains or microspores. So pollen mother cell diploid undergoes reduction division or meiosis, and it forms four haploid microspores. And these four microspores, they are arranged in a group of four. So we can call them as microspore tetrad. Here you can see the diagram. It is very important. With the help of diagram, you have it to explain for 3-mark question. Yeah, 5-mark question. So pollen mother cell, from where it is formed? Sporogenous tissue. Then it enlarges its size, having a prominent diploid nucleus and dense cytoplasm. It undergoes meiosis, meiosis 1, that means reduction division. Then the nucleus divides into two haploid nucleus. This again divides, second meiosis. So second meiosis, you know, it is divided into mitosis, simply a doubling. So two nucleus that will form four nuclei. And these four haploid nuclei then modifies and it forms four microspores. Nucleus surrounded by little bit of cytoplasm, and it forms separate cells. They are known as the microspores. The four microspores are formed in a group. So it is known as microspore tetrad. Now, when they get matured, on maturation, when these pollen grains get mature, they undergo dehydration, and these microspores will dissociate. The four microspore group that get dissociate, and they will develop into individual pollen grains. And pollen grains are released with the dehiscence of anther. And anther is dehisced with the help of stomium. The part of the anther that helps in dehiscence, that is the stomium. And these endothelial cells will play an important role in dehiscence. Here you can see some of the pollen grains, beautifully sculptured designs are there on its surface. So all these are the different pollen grains belonging to different plants. Now, what is the detailed structure of a particular pollen grain? Structure of a pollen grain. Pollen grain or microspores. Pollen grain is known as a microspore. In some of the textbook, it is written as male gametophyte, because these pollen grains carries the male gamete. So it is called male gametophyte, the stage that carries male gamete. So that is, pollen grains contains the or carries the male gamete. So another name of pollen grain is microspore. What is the shape? Here you can see the shape is, yes, spherical in shape. Then it possesses two layers. What are the two layers? Outer layer is exine and inner layer is indine. Two layers. Outer is exine and inner layer is indine. Now, exine, when you are observing, it is sculptured. It possesses different designs. It is rough. It is thick. And it is the outermost layer. It is protective in function. And it is made up of a polysaccharide that is called as sporopollenin. Very important question for your exam again. Name the polysaccharide that is resistant to organic matter, or it can withstand high temperature, and it is resistant to the reaction with acids or alkalis or even enzymes. So what is that particular polysaccharide that is present on the surface of the pollen grain? Your answer is sporopollenin. Sporopollenin. So, you know, because of the presence of this sporopollenin, since it is resistant to organic matter, or it can withstand high temperature, reaction with acids, alkalis, or even enzymes, we can store these pollen grains for longer period of time for later use. Or it is available as fossils also. Then, in some of these areas in the exine, you can see thin areas where the exine, the thickness of this exine is very, very less, or sporopollenin amount is less, or in some areas it is totally absent. So such area present on the surface of the pollen grains, that is known as germ pore. Now, what is the need for this germ pore? The need for germ pore is it helps in germination of the pollen grain. Pollen grain will germinate and pollen tube will come out through this germ pore. Then second layer is known as intyne. Second layer, innermost layer, that is known as intyne. And what it makes, it is made up of cellulose and pectin. So these are the two compounds, cellulose and pectin, that makes the intyne. Then, when you are observing a pollen grain, you can see inside the intyne, there present the plasma membrane. Because it is a normal cell, so cytoplasm is surrounded by plasma membrane. Then, here in this diagram, you see it possesses two cells. A pollen grain that possesses two cells. The single nucleus of the pollen grain that will divide and forms two nucleus. And each nucleus is surrounded by cytoplasm and membrane. It forms two different cells. Upper cell, the larger cell, that is known as vegetative cell, or at another name is generative cell. Vegetative cell or tube cell. And the lower cell, small cell, that is known as generative cell. So two cells, these two cells are unequal in shape. Larger cell, that is known as vegetative cell, or another name is tube cell. And lower cell, that is known as generative cell. In most of the plants, around 60% of the plants, these pollen grains are released in two-celled condition. So what are the two cells? Vegetative cell and generative cell. So two-celled condition. And in 40% of the plants, it is the pollen grains are released in three-celled stage. So what are the three cells? The first one is a vegetative cell that will remain as such, and generative cell will divide into two sperm. So these are the three different cells in a pollen grain. One is tube cell and the other is two sperm cell. Clear? So two-celled condition in most of the plants, pollen grains are released in two-celled stage. There, what are the two cells? Vegetative cell and generative cell. And in some plants, it is released in three-celled stage. There, what are the three cells? Vegetative cell and two sperm cells. Clear? Now, what are the disadvantages of pollen grains? Pollen grains have advantages as well as disadvantages. You know, there are certain people who are taking morning walk or evening walk in parks. During flowering season, they will enjoy and they will come back and they start sneezing. Why? It shows allergic reactions. So some of the pollen grains of some of the plants that shows allergic reactions, bronchial afflictions, and that will lead to chronic respiratory problems, disorders, for example, asthma or even bronchitis. So you might have seen one important plant that is mentioned in your textbook everywhere almost, that is Parthenium or carrot grass. Have you seen this plant in your school garden or in the school premises, playing grounds, anywhere? Yes. So this particular plant that is known as carrot grass or Parthenium. It is an exotic plant. Unwanted weed that is imported into our India along with the wheat. Now, for how long duration these pollen grains can live? It will remain in viable condition. And what are the factors that contributes for this viability of the pollen grains? So the different factors, that means first one is temperature and second is humidity. So these are the two factors that depends on the viability of pollen grains. In some of the plants, immediately after release of the pollen grains, that is within 30 minutes of a release of the pollen grain, these pollen grains that will lose its viability. So such a type of plants, for example, rice and wheat, after 30 minutes of release, the pollen grains becomes non-viable. Then in some of the plants, for example, rose, then beans, then Solanaceae plants. So these are the three different families, Rosaceae, Leguminaceae and Solanaceae. In these three families, these pollen grains can live for many months. Then we can store these pollen grains for longer period of time by storing them in nitrogen. Plus 196 degrees Celsius. Minus 196 degrees Celsius pe pollen grains ko liquid nitrogen mein we can protect and store. So that phenomenon, that is called a cryopreservation. So we can use the pollen grains of some of the plants for longer period of time. It is just like a seed bank. We can make pollen banks that will be used for crop breeding practices later. Now, what are the uses of pollen grains? So pollen grains are rich in nutrients. And because it is rich in nutrients, it is used for making pollen as well as syrups in foreign countries. Mainly these are used for making tablets, that is called pollen tablet, pollen syrup. So this is used as a food supplement because it is rich in nutrients. So in some cases, These athletes are using it for increasing their physical performance. As well as these race horses, it can also use. We can give this pollen tablet or syrup to race horses also for increasing their performance. Now, coming to the female reproductive structure. What is the female reproductive structure? Gynoecium. Or another name is pistil. It is the innermost essential whorl of a typical flower. And its use carpel. A pistil possesses sometimes only one carpel. Then it is known as monocarpellary. And sometimes it possesses two carpel, then it is bicarpellary. If it possesses three carpel, then we can say it as tricarpellary pistil. And in some plants, it possesses many carpels. So it is known as polycarpellary pistil. And this pistil may be sometimes fused. All the pistils are fused. Then it is called as syncarpous pistil. Syn means together. All the carpels present in a pistil that is fused together and it appears as a single structure. So it is known as syncarpous pistil. Here you can see on the left bottom side poppy flowers. The pistil of this poppy flower that is syncarpous pistil. Many carpels are there and all these carpels are united together and forms a single structure. So that condition is known as syncarpous pistil. Then the second one that is called as apocarpus. Apocarpus pistil means all the carpels of the pistil are free. For example, mycelia. Then what are the different parts of a pistil? Upper part, that is called as stigma. Then there is an elongated part that is interconnecting the stigma and the ovary. So that part is known as style. Then the basal swollen part, that is known as ovary. So, what are the three different parts of a pistil? That is stigma, style, ovary. Now, what is stigma? The upper flat receptive part of the pistil and it receives what? Pollen grains during pollination. Then, style is the middle part, narrow part, tubular part, cylinder part, and it is connecting the stigma with the ovary. Now coming to the ovary, ovary is the basal part, swollen part, and it has chambers inside. And these chambers are known as locules or ovarian chamber or ovarian cavity. And inside this ovarian cavity or ovarian chamber or the locule of the ovary, you can see white colored ovules. And these ovules are arranged in a specialized connective tissue. And that specialized connective tissue that is known as placenta. Here you can see the cross section of ovary. It possesses three chambers. Can you see? Yes. So, three locules or ovarian cavity or ovarian chamber. And in this chamber, you can see the ovules, white colored structures. And this white colored structure that is ovule, and ovules are arranged at the center with the help of a connective tissue that is called placenta. So, in 11th class, you have learned about this placentation. What are the different types of placentation? Axile, മാർജിനൽ, പെരിഫറൽ, സൂപ്പർഫിഷ്യൽ, ബേസൽ, പരേറ്റൽ, ലൈക്ക് ദാറ്റ്. യെസ് ഓർ നോ? യെസ്. സോ വാട്ട് ഈസ് ദ ടൈപ്പ് ഓഫ് പ്ലാസൻറ്റേഷൻ ഷോൺ ഹിയർ? യെസ് സെൻസ് ഇറ്റ് ഈസ് അറേഞ്ച്ഡ് ഓൺ ദ സെൻട്രൽ ആക്സിസ്. വാട്ട് ഈസ് ദ പ്ലാസൻറ്റേഷൻ? യെസ് ആക്സയിൽ. ഗുഡ്. സോ പ്ലാസൻ്റ ബയേഴ്സ് ദി ഓവ്യൂൾസ്. Now, coming to the number of ovule, ovule may be one or it may be many. And there are certain plants, for example, mango seed. Agar aapne mango ka seed dekha, to uske andar, that means mango ke andar kitane seed hai? Ek hi seed hai. That means it possesses only one ovule. Then in almost all the cereals, C-E-R-E-A-L-S cereals, anaj. In almost all these cereals, for example, wheat, rice, paddy, all these, they are present only one ovule in an ovary. And it shows which placentation? Basal placentation. Very good. Then, papaya as well as orchids. Then, watermelon, they are present so many ovules inside a single ovary. Now, these are your assignments for today. So, in this first part, you have learned the structure of a typical flower and its parts, then essential and non-essential worlds. Then what are the different essential worlds and non-essential worlds? Structure of andrecium and gynecium. Structure of a stamen and pistil. Then you have learned the microsporogenesis and megasporogenesis. Different types of pollen grains. So now come to the assignment for today. First question, filling the blanks. Dash is known as microsporophyll. Can you answer? Yes. Stamens are known as microsporophyll. What is meant by diathecous anther? Yes. Two. Theca means chamber. And anther lobe with two theca. That is called diathecous anther. Then, draw a neat labeled diagram of a bicelled pollen grain. What are the two cells present in a pollen grain? Vegetative cell or tube cell. And, yes, generative cell. Then, how many cells and how many nuclei are present in a mature embryo sac? So this you try to find it out. Then name the nutritive tissue present in an anther. Anther ke anther ka nutritive tissue kaun si hai? What is the name? Yes, tapetum. Dash is the homogeneous tissue present in an young anther. Young anther ke anther ka homogeneous tissue kaun si hai? What is the name? Yes, sporogenous tissue. What is the ploidy? Ploidy, chromosome number 2n is equal to, yes, that means diploid. It is diploid, having two sets of chromosomes. So, hope you enjoyed the session. If you have any doubts, come with your doubts in the next session. So, read and learn all the concepts. Stay safe and be healthy. Bye.